हेलो हेलो गुड इवनिंग एवरीबॉडी। हाउ आर यू गाइस आफ्टर ऑफिस 8 आवर्स इन मीटअप। गाइस वी गोइंग टू लर्न अ लॉट ऑफ थिंग्स विद मी because I understand after working 8 hours we came here in meetups to learn something new, so you will because here good I think one more talk is here, so I'm going to talk about building microservices with Golang and how we will manage our microservices with Mesos. So guys, let me first introduce myself. I don't have any slide for myself, okay, so I'm going to tell. So myself is Praveen. I came from India, so this is my social visit here. So I run 3 technical community in Delhi, Ruby, Golang and Cloud Foundry. Because I personally believe community and meetups are good place to share our knowledge and learn from people what industries and what expert people are working on and where this complete industry is moving on. So keep ourselves up to date what new tool technology I am using, what others are using, so that's a good place. I was also one of organizer of first GoferConf India in 2014-15. It's my social visit, so thoughts of meeting local gophers, community people. So I started looking is there meetup groups in Singapore or not. So I find, so I contact with Dan. So I really thanks to Dan for giving this opportunity and platform to meeting with you all. So without spending any more time, so let's me start my talk. So I'm going to cover what are the pain points of running monolith and layered application, and this pain point could be solved with the microservices. When we are building microservices, then Go is one of the best languages that what I feel will fit for writing microservices. Then once we decided moving our monolith and layered application to microservices and we decided our language, then few points we need to keep in mind because it's complete architecture of application and system development. First I will talk about a little about building, integration and deploying our microservices, okay, a few challenges, then questions and answers, and the guys Mr. feel free to ask any questions, okay. Let's make this session interactive. So how many of you are using Golang in production? Okay, so rest of you are learning Golang, trying to adopt Golang. Okay, great. How many of you are working in a startup? Okay, so I assume rest of you are coming from a mid-size or bigger organization, and there must be some applications sitting in the corner people don't want to touch, don't want to work, because very big application, okay. Then our manager come and said, hey, do you want to work this project? I said, no, I don't want to work, because we know it's very big application, a couple of teams are working on this project, okay. So I want something experiment with a new language, new tool, some small application, and the slowly is getting becoming very challenging for organization running this kind of application because of its monolith nature. So when I'm saying monolith, so I'll give you one example. 3 years back, 4 years back, we was building a PaaS platform. You know PaaS platform? Platform as a service. Heroku, Cloud Foundry. So we was trying to build a PaaS platform. So we was about 20 people, developer. In 6 to 7 months, we built our PaaS, developed our PaaS. After that, we started adding new features. And slowly what we realized, our productive team, the 20 people developed that PaaS platform, we become unproductive because there was a million lines of code. Before adding any feature, we need to think thrice, could my code will break something else? Could my code will break other component logic? And we was not able to put ourselves compared with our competitor. So other competitor adding features, new release every week, every day. So that time we realize that is what our fault, that what we have done. We have the industry expert people, developer, and today we are sitting in the place we're not able to add new release, new features. So we understood it's because of we have very big application. It's very legacy application. Then we broke down that application into microservices. So microservices are monolith. So let's understand a few points about monolith. If you have one build, if you have one code base, if you have one technology stack, then you are monolith. If you talk about the layer, then you have UI technology, you have the backend technology, okay, API technology, you have the backend technology. So again, it could be layered systems. But there is some benefits. So from a decade, companies are using, they are developing a monolith application. So there are few benefits for developers. They have the simple mental model of development. They know I have single applications, I'm working on this code base. Same goes for the operation team. They know I have this technology stack. I need to configure for production. I need to make another instance. I need to deploy, redeploy, scale, scale out. Again, a few points we need to understand. As I said, after working 6 months on a PaaS platform, we become unproductive. Because when our development tool get overburdened, means our refactoring take days. Our testing takes weeks. Our build takes hours. Means we are in monolith. In terms of scaling, I have been problem with performance. I scaled my application with the 10 instances. Still, I'm facing problem with the performance. So what happened, I'll take an example. I use one scenario. In my organization, we had one product called backend as a service. Every 5 minutes, okay, we are doing backend call, and we are updating our database with a million of data. So this calls going in every 10 seconds. Okay, when we scale that complete instance application with 10 instances, we scale horizontally, that the same computing things goes with the 10 instances, 10 applications. Okay, so if you go for microservices, so we divide our application basis of the functional and the computation box. So if I need to scale that part, we scale only that part only. when our deployment is limited, means we are doing a monthly release, 2 month release, then we are in monolith. When a system grows out of limit, we had 10 teams, we build 20 teams, 15 teams, okay, still we are not more productive. Developer blaming testers. Testers start blaming developers. And product manager blaming, I have budget problem. I was expecting 5 more developers, 2 more testers. So we are somewhere in monolith application development. Our application is monolith. Therefore, we have microservices. Okay, so let's understand microservice. Microservices are a small and autonomous service that work together. One application will split into 10, 20, 100 small microservices for doing a small and single work. If we elaborate this definition, then it could be a small and focused on doing one thing well. Again, if we decompose it more, then functional system decomposition into manageable and independent deployment component. We can break our complete monolith application with the 100 microservices, but that should be manageable. That should deploy independent. So micro refer for the size. So our microservice should be something one application, 2-3 developers working together. That code base should fit in their mind. And that should be functionally decomposed, and microservice should have not depend on other microservices. They do inter-process communication. It could be API call, it could be message-based, event-based architecture. So when how we understand so how many microservices we will have. So we decompose our microservices based on our functionality, okay, based on our resource consumptions, based on our resource like verb. If you take example of e-commerce application, so we can make one application that will handle profile, that could handle order, shipping, cart. When we decompose this complete application, so we create one microservice for profile. That microservice will only take off profile management, profile update, keeping record of the customer. Another microservice could be cart. That will only take care of the cart when the customer adding some items, that will goes to cart. Another would be order. Again, these small microservices need to talk to each other. So we could make an event-based architecture. It could be a REST call, REST API call, depend on the kind of a task, kind of dependency one microservice has with other. Okay. And our microservice should deploy independently. Should not depend on the other microservices. For managing this up, if you take example, as at present I was reading a blog, Netflix having 600 microservices. Can we imagine how big infrastructure they have? It will become really tough for managing these many microservices. So for managing these microservices, we can use some tools like Kubernetes, Mesos, for managing and deploying, for continuous delivery integration. So we already covered this. So when we are developing microservices, so few points like see, four things I always keep in mind when we do a microservices-based architecture. First is the independent code base. Another is the scaling base. Third one is the features. Fourth one is the deployment. Okay? So code base is maintainable for developer. It fit into their brain. One microservices, two developers are working, so they're able to understand their complete application code base. If this could be monolith, it's a very big application. You know, 100 people are working this complete project. I don't know what this X guy is working. So if it's microservices, it's still 100 people, 100 developers working in this complete application, but they are on microservices. They know what I'm working on. So tool like building, testing, refactoring, it takes seconds, okay? For if very big application, I done a small changes. So again, complete application need to be tested. Complete application need to be built. Complete application need to be redeployed. And if you're going to halt your all complete application, complete platform. But it could be microservices. Then if I added a small UI changes, okay, I'm going to deploy one component. We have done some changes in our profile. Microservices. It could be in CP. I'm going to redeploy only one microservice, not complete application. If this complete application goes down for somehow, okay, I need to call my development team, my testing team, my operation team, and everybody sitting in the office for 3 days, 4 days. We are adding, fixing bugs, testing again, redeploying again. So it would not be case if it's a microservice architecture. So two guys are working together, something goes wrong, okay? So they will roll back the code base, redeploy. They will work again separately. They feel it's done, it's doing the job what I'm expecting, they can redeploy. Independent technology stack. It's one of the beauty of microservices. So if we have only the application, so we assume 10 years back we started this business development. Maybe we started JSP, J2E. Take an example. We started in Ruby on Rails. And it's been 10 years we're using the same technology stack. If it's microservices, okay, so we can use microservice that fit for doing, we use the language that do the things better. If take an example, if we are playing with a task, something is CPU intensive, memory intensive, okay, so we can prefer using Golang. We could prefer using Node.js. If something kind of script kind of work, doing some scripting, we can go for Python, we can go for Ruby language. So here we are independent with the technology stack. Today I feel Python is not doing good job. It's not best for this microservice. We could go and experiment with the other languages. We try it out. Because we need adding a small microservice in other languages. We will test it out again. Well, it's not fit, it's not work. Again, we always feel to go back with the previous language, previous tool. Team can experiment new technology with microservices. We can select a stack that's very lightweight. So these are few points. If you talk about scaling, okay. So even I address this, we see which microservice need to scale. You don't need to scale complete application. If something I need to scale with my shipping microservice, we scale CPU microservices with the 10 instances, 2 instances. I'm not going to scale my complete all microservices. again, I talked about these feature things. We can play with our microservices with adding new features, deploying, testing. It won't take much time. So now here Go comes in picture. So why Go is best for writing REST services? I played with the Ruby language, Python, Node.js, okay? And I believe every language have their own history, their own features, own peak time. Every language have their frameworks. And that's what meant. No language having something we cannot develop. But here we need to decide which language, which framework going to fit for which task, which microservices. So I prefer Go because Go is the language that come in between dynamic language and static language. If people work from the static language, so we prefer using a static language for safety point of view. Because codes got compiled, okay, then we are redeploying it. If we are working in the dynamic language, okay, so it's very efficient language. So Go is language that took features of the dynamic language and the static language, so we can get both things, our efficiency and our safety. So why Go? Go is good for performance. It's have inbuilt concurrency. It's easy to handle errors. So it's one of the very good part of Go language. Take an example. If we are writing a function, okay. So function could return two things with the expected result, or it could be error. So we can expect both things. We can handle our errors. So it's inbuilt in the Go language. Safety is a static language, as I said. Fast development. It's very easy language. Next slide, I will cover why it's very. We do fast development like dynamic language, and it has inbuilt and limited libraries that do pretty good work. There is not too many libraries I need to go and play around. And these libraries are provided by a community and the Go itself. So if you talk about simplicity, so Go have only 25 keywords. This is a simple example. Python having 33, Ruby having 41, and C having 32. So first thing, I'm not mean for 20. I could go and remember 33 keywords. Okay, I can remember 41 keywords. But why would I remember that many keywords if 25 is enough? In Golang, there is for loop. Every language having the condition, for loops, right? For writing our condition. Golang having single for loop. Single loop conditions, for loop. There is no switch, there is no do, there is no while. We can achieve our do functionality, switch functionality with for only. Could I write here? Then? Okay. So just I want to give a simple example so you understand how Go is easy. How easy it is. There are some inbuilt library you can use Node, Achieves, encoding, cryptography, HTML, templating, generic SQL drivers, logging systems, and many more libraries We go and go like package websites, you can see. We'll talk about the last slide, okay? So next, let's talk about this Go tools. Go having some inbuilt tools, okay? One of the things I would like to talk here about Go FMT. Go having a tool, Go FMT, that format our code. So if you talk, if you go and see you know, a Stack Overflow and the language community, you will always find there is a thread, people keep asking what is the best way of writing our code base? What is the best way to doing formatting? It should be a space, it should be tab, it should be 4 space, it should be 8 space. But in Golang, it's handled very, they have given this a tool called GoFMT. So just you have to write in your working directory GoFMT and it will format your complete code base, complete project. So I have when I was working with developers, okay, there we need to tell them, hey guys, please do format your code. There is a few ideas you can use of line. So sometimes you have to add a package and you can reduce it. So this tool called Go Link, Go Wait, Go Test, Go Doc for doing documentation. So any question about Golang? So is it clear what I'm talking about? Or Sample Module 5. Okay, okay.
Comparison between different languages of code.
Okay, so let me give you one small example. Everyone know for loop, okay. For what we do? I equals to 1, okay, I less than 10, I plus plus, and we will write some of our code over here, okay. So this is a general for loop. If we remove this part, if we remove this part, okay, then it's become, sorry, other language having a for, do, and while, right? For we are having the three keywords like initialization, increment, sorry, conditions and increment, right? And here if you remove this part, so it's become do for us. When we remove increment, this becomes while for us. Okay? Some example of, could you give me any program could have been writing for that? So, you will understand better. Examples.
So, this program is a tool from how does program. How does a function in Golang return two values? How does a function in Golang return two values? I just was talking right that a function in Golang can
return
two values.
So we're adding function here something funks, get. Okay. So here we are passing a parameter. It could be I, it could be string. Let's make it s. Okay. Here we can return. Result as string and error. It could be error. Now, when we do the gun type, okay, we are adding a return. So, when this function will get called, okay, here we will have the result and error. And we are will call this method get, we will pass parameter here like say name. And here we could check this error if error not equals to null, then we will throw out print error or throw something log dot printf error. So let's understand. Here I am calling this method. Okay, and I passed parameter name. Okay, so here I will get name on this string type s. Okay, and it will return result as a string. Okay, even it could return error here. And here we are getting two different types. One is string result, another is error. And we could check our error. If we have error, then it will break our code here. Okay, or we will do something here. Otherwise, it will passed on. Understand?
But you return is only one.
I have not written anything. So here I specified it have two return type. Okay. So what we could do, I removed here. Okay. I removed error. Now here I need to return. Here we will do something, some calculations of business logics. Okay. So after I need to specify here, it could be result, it could be error something. So here error, I assign something x, okay, and the result having something name. So I have to take care of both things, error and result. When we are writing microservices, so any other question on the Golang before the moving to the next slide? That's fine. So when we are moving from monolith to microservices, so we need to take care of few things like rapid provisioning, basic monitoring, and the rapid application deployment. For doing all these things, we can use some CI/CD tools like Jenkins. Okay, for orchestration, we can use Kubernetes. We can use Mesos. So when we have the microservices, then we could face with the integration issues. Bringing software into the production will become little hard because we have the 110, 20 microservices. It will take a lot of time if you not do automate all this deployment, integration, and deployment. And it could be error prone. For handling all these things, we can use integration, continuous integration. So continuous integration, we can use Jenkins. Jenkins is the tool for this open source tool that for continuous system integration. If 10 teams working on the 10 applications, and when they are checking out their code, so their code will be get tested, it will get deployed. We can repeat build test our software project. We can configure automatic everything like integration test, unit test, functional test. So it's a little DevOps things. The benefit what we get about code will be always consistent state, code will be always compiled, it will be automatic tested. Developer will get feedbacks before going code to production. And we can manage this whole cluster using Mesos. Mesos is the tool for cluster management. And actually what Mesos does, if we have the 10 VMs, so we can represent 10 VMs with the single VMs. And it will manage all resources. Mesos is a scalable and distributed resource manager designed to manage resource for the data centers. Marathon, we can use Marathon for application deployment and make sure application is up and running. This is a more DevOps tool. So further challenge could be testing, transaction, authentication. So guys, when we are moving our application from monolith to microservices, so it's not always recommended to go and adopt microservices. Okay, few things we need to keep in mind, because we have the experience on building microservice architecture. Okay, and what could be the alternatives options? Do our team is ready for adopting microservices? Do we are ready for adopting new tools? We are ready to play with the new languages. So this is just an option. Okay, so you have, before using microservices, you have to understand your requirement. You should talk with communities, understand, read blogs, then you could go for adopting microservices. Any questions? So I have done with my talk. Yeah. Yeah.
And how do you compare it with also with the Docker form?
Yeah. Yeah. So Mesos, Kubernetes, and Docker Swarm for orchestration. So how it works? I will give a simple example. Okay. Recently, I was doing one POC with Mesos. Okay. Same things you can achieve with the Docker also. So my DevOps team having about 100 Jenkins server, and these servers are given to individual teams. Because every team doing their integration, application integration and deployment. So what Mesos do, Mesos having the framework called Marathon. Okay? And the Mesos orchestrate our data center. Means once we install our So, Mesos is the tool for managing our data center orchestration. Okay. So, if you how Mesos work? Mesos have a concept of master and slave. Okay. Take an example. We have 6 VM. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. We want to make this all VMs as a single machine. So we will install our Mesos on one VM, okay, and we install slaves on this remaining 5 VMs. And in from Mesos, we will get single machine. We are able to see single machine, okay, whereas we deploy our application. So that time, master will decide which slaves having the resource. On that slaves, it will deploy our application. It could go on 3, it could go on 5, it could go on 6.
What if the master goes down?
Master, yeah. There we have option, there is, we can make multiple master. Okay? So, if you do this complete orchestration, so we'll have 3 master, 1, 2, 3. We can make 3 master, okay? We can make 3 slaves. And we'll load balance this master with zookeeper. So zookeeper will make sure one master is always up and running. If one master is goes down, so another master will get up and take responsibility of the main master. When we are deploying any application, okay, so master will is keep pinging and taking which slaves having the resource available, and it will deploy this application on that slaves. Any question?
Do you use Mesos and
Kubernetes? I use Mesos, but Kubernetes do same pattern. Mesos is for the big organization, for cluster or data center. Kubernetes could use for managing VMs, couple of VMs, 100, 200 VMs.
Would it be easier if we just use Kubo or Cloud Foundry to manage our microservices rather than?
Yeah, you can try. So I have played with the Cloud Foundry. We have actually one POCs where we having about 10 microservices. We have deployed on Cloud Foundry. Okay. Later, for giving this complete system to our testing team, we done this all orchestration on Kubernetes. So this is the when we are doing a microservices architecture. So microservices are talking to each services with event-based, could be event-based or REST-based. Okay, so our microservice should expose REST endpoints. So it could deploy anything. Any other question? More memories and CPU. So on one VM, we could have the multiple microservices. Could be two, could be three. We need to decide what kind of task our microservice is doing.
A few minutes.